Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to our Advent service, the second Sunday of Advent. It is wonderful that we can all be gathered together today to receive from our Lord's hand his many mercies for us. We have just a couple of announcements as we begin today. A reminder that this coming Wednesday and the Wednesday after that, we have two more Wednesday night Advent services, 6 p.m. supper, 7 p.m. service. Other reminders is that we have a Christmas Eve program led by our Sunday school kids, beginning at 5:45 on Christmas Eve, with the program beginning at 6 p.m. Christmas Day service will be at 9:30 a.m., no Sunday school. And other announcements then will be in your bulletin. One other reminder that we are approaching the last day you will have in order. Next Sunday, a week from today, is your last day to order the women's Bible studies. So if you are interested in getting one of those, talk to Lynn or go to one of the circles on Tuesday. Are there any other announcements today that are not in our bulletin? If not, then we open our worship service this morning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. I invite you to rise as you are able for our call to worship. Our call to worship is Psalm 85, and let us read it responsively. Lord, you were favorable to your land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave
all their sin.
You withdrew all your wrath. You turned from your hot anger. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger to all generations? Show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Surely his salvation is near to those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Faithfulness springs up from the ground, and righteousness looks down from the sky. Righteousness will go before him and make his footsteps a way. I invite you to remain standing now as we have our praise song, Do You Hear What I Hear?
Way up in the sky.
forward Jack and Isaac to light our Advent candles.
The second candle on the Advent wreath is called the Peace Candle. With this candle, we are pointed back to the words of Isaiah 9, when Jesus is referred to as the Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. In a time when the world is full of violence and pain, Jesus gives us his peace each and every day through his word. It is this word which delivers us to us God's message of love and forgiveness. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you that we can have this peace inside of us. We pray that despite the challenges of the world, that your word would continue to give us our spirit's peace. Amen.
Amen. Our order of service now continues on page 2 of your ambassador hymnals. Let us bow before the Lord and confess our sins. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy and ask you for Christ's sake, grant us forgiveness of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Because of the promise of God and the completed work of Christ on the cross, I declare to you today that your sins are forgiven. Amen. You now have the privilege to hear the word of our living God. And I will invite you to stand as you are able out of respect for the reading of God's word.
The Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry. And I said, what shall I cry? All flesh is grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows on it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God will stand forever. Go on up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom, and gently lead those that are with the young. The epistle lesson is from 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 14. But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as a thousand years, and a thousand years is one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, since you are waiting for these, be diligent to be found by him without spot or blemish and at peace. Here ends the reading.
And our gospel lesson for today comes from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight.'" John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Here ends the reading of God's word. Amen. You may be seated. Please remain standing as you are able, as now we confess with the church of all times and in all places our holy Christian faith, this morning using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And you may be seated, as at this time I'll invite our ushers forward to receive our morning offering. At the same time, then, I invite you to sing alongside us as we sing, "O Come, Emmanuel."
Thank you.
to the Lord of all mercy. Heavenly Father, we praise you that we have the opportunity to be gathered together today. Lord, we praise you for your infinite grace, mercy, wisdom, and kindness that you have given us the ability to show up together, that you have given us voices with which to praise you, hearts with which to love you, eyes with which to behold your glory, ears with which to hear your word. Lord, we ask that you would be with each and every one of us as we go about our day today. We ask that you would be giving us your continued blessings and care, that we would be able to worship and glorify you in all things that we say and do. Lord, we think of those in our congregation today who are suffering, asking of your infinite grace and mercy that you would be near to them, that you would give them your grace. We think of our shut-ins, including Juanita, Diane, Joanne, and Delbert. For those who are in need of healing, we think of Gordon, Zach, Linda, Tim, Norm, DJ, Grayson, Danielle, Robert, Francis, Sandra, Terry, Casey, Michael, Ty, Blake, Dwayne, and Leslie. Lord, for the children of our congregation, we ask that you would be blessing and keeping them, including Willa, Charlie, Claire, Eloise, Gwen, Rowan, Lane, Waylon, Kennedy, Elena, Madeline, and Joanna. Lord, for our church council, we ask that you would be with Tracy, Dane, Craig, Corey, and Stuart. Lord, for our nation, our government, and world lead, and all those who are in authority, we ask that you would be providing wisdom and proper judgment, that the calls that need to be made would be made knowing that it is for the best of the people they serve. For those who are in the military and their families, we ask you would give them peace in the unknown times, comfort in the hard times, joy in the sad times, and that you would be with your people. Lord, for these and all other things, we trust in your mercy and your grace, knowing that even the deepest groanings of our heart are not hidden from you. So we ask, Heavenly Father, that you would answer, that you would love, and that you would see and hear. In your name we pray all these things. Amen. At this time, I will invite you to stand as you are able as we sing, Behold Our God. Our sermon lesson this morning comes from our Old Testament lesson. I invite you to remain standing as you are able as I reread for us Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry, and I say, what shall I cry? All flesh is like grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades. When the breath of the Lord blows on it, surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Go on up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not, say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Behold, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will tend his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. He will carry them in his bosom and gently lead those that are with young. Would you pray with me now? Heavenly Father, these are your words and your word is truth. Sanctify us today in that truth. Convict us of sin in our lives where that is necessary. Comfort and encourage us with the promises of your gospel. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. We face a very major problem. Dane briefly touched on it on Wednesday. But I'm going to dig into it just a little bit as well. We live in a world that not only is full of pain, hardship, sin, and death, but one that in all reality worships these things. How often do we consider the fragility of our lives? How often do we consider the pain and suffering caused by warfare, famine, and trials? How often does our reaction end up being, well, glad it's me and not them, or glad it's them and not me? The nation of Israel had been through the very worst that they could be put through. Prior to this passage in Isaiah, the southern faithful kingdom of Judah systematically had had each of their fortified cities surrounding Jerusalem taken out one at a time by the nation of Assyria. And the Lord provided them a release when Jerusalem was besieged by that great army of 180,000 people. And when Assyria fell to the king of Babylon, Babylon marched in and finished the job, besieging Jerusalem, breaking down her mighty walls, tearing down the temple, forcing each and every person in that nation of Judah, in that great city of Jerusalem, into exile, slavery, suffering. And you could say quite confidently that this was just recompense for their sin and their unbelief. That the nation of Israel chose, instead of serving to serve God, they chose to serve themselves and their own passions and their own desires. But here I say to you now, how great should your punishment be? You who live in a world where we love to serve our own passions, our own idols, our own wants and desires. I would venture to say that the punishment that you or I would deserve, should we follow the same manner of punishment that Israel themselves received, would be more like death. Eternal suffering and death, not simply exile for 70 years. Because over the course of the last 2,500 years since Israel went into exile, sin has only gotten more prevalent in our world. The human heart has only become more depraved. Our lives have only become more prone to falling into sin. And as a matter of fact, sinning has become something that is commonplace and argued over whether or not it's actually sin. Rather than confessing our sins to God, we attempt to justify them, saying that we are absolutely in the right for our sin because of this, that, or the other thing. And when we realize the just punishment we deserve for our sin, when we realize that we are possibly worse than the nation of Israel back in 587 BC, we realize just how wonderful of a promise God gives in our text today. To this broken down nation, to these people who are scattered to all ends of the earth, to God's people who have abandoned God time and time again and finally received the just punishment for that sin, Isaiah delivers them a message. Comfort, my people. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem. Her warfare is ended. Her iniquity is pardoned. She has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. And how can we be sure of that fact? Because there's a voice. A voice that cries in the wilderness to prepare the way of the Lord, to make straight a highway for our God. A voice that cries that there is one coming after me whose sandal I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. A voice crying in the wilderness, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. This voice of John the Baptist cries not to point you to John the Baptist, not to point you back to your own self and your own self-pity, but to point you forward to the end of your warfare, to the pardoning of your iniquity, to the repayment of all of your sin. The voice cries in the wilderness to point you to the coming Messiah, the coming Savior, who, as we know from our Advent candle readings, is promised to give us peace, to give us hope. Those five candles there, they each signify something regarding this season of Advent. You can have hope. You can have peace. You are giving joy. You are given Christ. And that's what Isaiah points us forward to here. That it is Christ. The glory of the Lord shall be revealed. All flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. And here Isaiah has a little bit of dialogue, a little bit of questioning. This voice that cries for Isaiah to speak tenderly, this voice that calls Isaiah to show the pardon, the voice that cries the one in the wilderness to come and prepare the way of the Lord, this voice now commands Isaiah to cry. And this word cry here is another way of saying proclaim. Share that message. And Isaiah, a product of his time, asks the question, what shall I cry? The whole world's in turmoil. Our entire lives have been flipped upside down. Right is wrong and wrong is right. What in the world is there for me to proclaim? All flesh is like grass. All of its beauty is like the flower of the fields. And what happens to grass right about this time of year? It dies. What happens to the flowers in your garden? They die. The people are grass. And the grass withers. And the flower fades. But, Isaiah says, the word of our God will stand forever. This confession of faith that Isaiah has in God and in his promises is the entire basis for Isaiah's message in this portion of Isaiah chapter 40. He is reiterating all of the promises that God has given to his people throughout the entire ministry of Isaiah. And he's saying, even though the grass withers, even though the flower fades, even though mankind and its beauty will pass away over and over again, yet the word of our Lord remains forever. The promises of our God will stand forever. And what promises does he give in this passage? The promise that your warfare against sin, death, and the powers of hell is ended. That your iniquity, your selfishness, your unrighteousness has been pardoned. That the Lord has laid on his only Son double the punishment for all of your sin. That he will tend his flock like a shepherd. That he will gather his lambs in his arms and carry them close to his chest and lead those who are with young. The imagery that God gives to us in this passage is the imagery of Him being our great shepherd and us being His sheep. Though we wander, though we stray, though even though we continually fail everything He has called for us to do, yet He is patient and loving with us. And He gives us His grace and mercy. For Jerusalem, this is a promise that they would return home. Go up on a high mountain. O Zion, you are a herald of good news. Zion is the mountain where the temple stood. O Jerusalem, you are the herald of good news. The people of God will one day return. So lift up this message and fear not. Your God comes with might. His arm rules for Him. His reward is with Him. His recompense is before Him. The promise that God gives through Isaiah to the people of Jerusalem is that they would return. They would rebuild their temple. They would worship God as one people yet again. And to you as God's people, God has promised you. O Zion, herald of good news, the new and greater Jerusalem promised for you is your herald of good news, that your God has not finished His work for you, that your God has not suddenly stopped preparing a place for you, but that He is returning again, and that He is preparing Zion, a new and greater Zion, a new and greater Jerusalem, where the Lord your God is there with His might, ruling as the sun, that the reward He has for you is eternal, dear child of God. So that in this world of darkness and pain and sin and unrighteousness, you have a hope, you have a peace, because your God's word stands forever. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Amen. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus now and forever, and His peace will be with you always. Amen. At this time, I will invite you to stand as you are able as we sing Light of the World.
So
At this time, I will invite you to bow with me as we pray the prayer that our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Pastor, I know that Cole's looking pretty relaxed because he thought we would forget his birthday, but we wouldn't forget his birthday. So I was wondering if you would lead us in happy birthday to Cole.
Cole Hazelbring's birthday is today. And I am going to give a little stare to everyone else who did not tell me this earlier. Let's sing. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Cole. Happy birthday to you. Many more birthdays to, many more birthdays to. God bless you and keep you another year through. Now that he's bright red, let's sing our closing song, Days of Elijah.
And these are
Now go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.